Welcome to the last part of this lecture in the second module on theoretical abstractions in data flow analysis. I would like to summarize what we have seen so far. We first begin by looking at the requirements. The necessary and sufficient condition for designing a data flow framework are the following. We need a meet semilattice satisfying a descending chain condition. We need a function space in which functions are monotonic. When we have a meet semilattice, the meet operator is commutative, associative, and idempotent. It's important for us to check that the meet that we are choosing satisfies these properties. Also, the partial order that we define for our data flow analysis must be reflexive, transitive, and antisymmetric. And if the meet is defined properly, the existence of bottom is already ensured. And the function space must be closed under composition, and the existence of identity function is required to model the basic blocks that do not change the data flow values. So this summarizes the requirements of a data flow framework. And how have we arrived at? So we have first looked at the data flow values and their modeling using lattice theory. And we also defined a notion of soundness of the information represented by data flow value. Then we talked about the flow functions that would compute data flow values corresponding to different statements. Then we talked about the solutions of data flow analysis in terms of data flow values. And now we wish to talk about the algorithms for performing data flow analysis that would compute the solutions that we are interested in. In particular, we are interested in the MFP solution. So we want to look at algorithms for computing MFP. We will talk about the complexity of data flow analysis, and we will also talk about the factors affecting the complexity of data flow analysis. We will look at what is called the iterative methods for performing data flow analysis. There are other methods called elimination methods, modeled after Gaussian elimination method, but they have not been found to be practically efficient. So we will restrict ourselves to iterative methods. They essentially involve successive recomputation after a conservative initialization, and this conservative initialization is the top value of the lattice. And the first method that we look at, and this is a method that we have been using, is what is called a round robin method. The name indicates that this algorithm performs repeated traversals over nodes of the control flow graph in a fixed order. So there's one traversal of the nodes in a specific order, and there's another traversal over all the nodes in the same order. And the algorithm terminates after the value stabilizes, which means that after traversal I and traversal I plus 1, when we find that all values at all nodes in the control flow graph are identical, the values in I plus 1 iteration are same as the values obtained in the ith iteration, then we say that we have indeed computed a fixed point of the data flow equations. And because we start with the top value, we have computed the maximum fixed point solution. That's what we wish to compute. The benefit of this method is it is simplest to understand and implement. This is what we have been using all along. The drawback of this method is that it may perform some unnecessary computation. Hence, practical data flow analysis uses some other method called a worklist based method. The idea is to maintain a dynamic list of nodes which need recomputation. So when the data flow value of a node changes, if it's a forward data flow problem, the data flow value of its successor nodes may have to be recomputed, but not necessarily its predecessor node, unless the node happens to be in a loop. So what this algorithm does is it finds out which are the nodes that need recomputation, puts them to a worklist, and a step of the algorithm picks up a node from the worklist, performs a computation, and adds some more nodes to the worklist. And the algorithm terminates when the work list becomes empty. On the positive side, this is a demand-driven method in the sense that it avoids unnecessary computation. It speculates where the computation might be required and adds only those nodes to the worklist, and only those nodes get reprocessed. On the negative side, there are overheads of maintaining the worklist. We will see an interesting algorithm which combines the benefit of round robin algorithm and the worklist algorithm both into one. So I talked about elimination methods. They essentially involve delayed computations of dependent data flow values. For example, if we have a loop, the data flow values of the nodes within the loop are dependent on the loop entry, assuming it's a forward data flow problem. So these methods work by finding suitable single entry regions, and there are two methods. One is called interval-based analysis, which partitions the graph into a collection of intervals. And then there's something else called T1, T2 based analysis, which parses the graph by identifying certain structures in the graph. As I said before, we are not going to talk about these methods. So in order to understand the round robin method and the complexity of the method, we need to understand different kinds of edges in a graph. So we want to classify the edges in a graph. So we have a certain graph G, which looks like a control flow graph. In all control flow graphs, we have a unique entry node and a unique exit node. The entry node has no predecessor and the exit node has no successor. So we would like to identify, we would like to distinguish between different kinds of edges based on constructing a depth first spanning tree of G. So this is a spanning tree, and any spanning tree would be okay, but we use depth first spanning tree. Note that there can be multiple spanning trees. I mean, we could have chosen this edge 5 to 8 rather than 7 to 8, depending upon how we traversed. So if we traverse this node first instead of this node, it would still have been a depth first spanning tree. But the idea is that we choose one particular spanning tree. If we choose some other spanning tree, our classification of the edges could change a little. So we identify edges in these four categories. The first category of edges is a back edge, denoted in red. So this is a back edge, this is an example of a back edge, and this is another example of a back edge. So these are all back edges. And how are back edges identified? Back edges are the edges that go from a node in the spanning tree to its ancestor node. So node 5, this edge from 5 to 2 is an edge from 5 to 2, and 2 is an ancestor of 5 in the back edge. Similarly, 4 to 4 is a back edge. Similarly, 7 to 6 is a back edge. The interesting thing about this spanning tree is that if we change the spanning tree, in general, the back edges could change. However, if you have a special kind of a graph called reducible flow graph, in which all loops are single entry loops, then it doesn't matter which spanning tree we use, the set of back edges essentially remain the same. We also identify something called a forward edge. So the most important and the simplest edge to understand is, first let's talk about the tree edges. These are the edges that are present in the spanning tree. So we have 1 to 6, 6 to 7, 7 to 8. All these are shown as brown here. These are all tree edges. So edges that are present are tree edges, and the edges that are not present in the depth first spanning tree but are present in the control flow graph G are divided into three categories. The first category we saw is a back edge, which is an edge from a node to its ancestor. Then there is a forward edge, which is a node which is an edge from a node to its descendant, and this is an edge which is not present. So 6 to 8 is a forward edge. So this is a forward edge, 6 to 8. So this is an edge from a node to its descendant, not immediate descendant, but some other descendant. The third category of edges is a cross edge, where these edges go from a node to some other node with which it has neither descendant nor ancestor relationship. So these are the four kinds of edges. We are not really interested in all these four kinds of edges. We essentially make a distinction between forward edges and back edges. We retain back edges as they are and club forward, cross edges and the tree edges, all of them into what we call as forward edges. So as far as we are concerned, we just have forward edges or back edges in a control flow graph. Okay, and then a reverse post order of a graph is a topological sort of the graph obtained after removing the back edges. So we identified the back edges and then we just remove the back edges and do any topological sort. So these are some possible reverse post order for the same graph. Note that practically reverse post order of a graph is determined by a depth first search over the graph. So it's not that we first actually construct a data structure to compute a spanning tree and then remove edges and then sort it. A single procedure, depth first search, gives us everything, the order and the identification of an edge that goes from a node to some other node whose depth first order is smaller than it, then it becomes a back edge. So here is our round robin iterative algorithm that we have been using all along. So we have left compute, we have shown it for forward data flow analysis. The computation of out has been left implicit and it works fine for unidirectional flows. So what does our algorithm do? For all nodes, so we assume that 0 is the start node. So for all other nodes, the in of I is made top, in of 0 is made boundary information. And then we say change is equal to true. And while there is a change, we execute this particular loop. And at the start of the loop, we say change is false. And then we iterate over all the nodes in the control flow graph. And we compute a temporary value from the by applying the flow function of the predecessor to entry of all the predecessors. So effectively, this is the meat of all outs. We compute it, and if we find that it's the same as the previous value associated with the entry point of node J, then there's nothing to be done. There is no change. However, if there is a change, we revise the value. We say in J equal to temp, and we say change is equal to true. So as soon as change is equal to true is set at some point for some node, we will re-enter this while loop, and all these iterations will be done once again, which means that every node will be visited once again. Top is the identity of the meet operation, and here we have not indicated that in the algorithm, we use reverse post order traversal for efficiency. Here we are talking about a forward data flow analysis. If you were to do a backward data flow analysis such as live variables analysis, then we will use a post order traversal rather than reverse post order traversal. When we perform reverse post order traversal and there are no loops in the program, there's no need of initialization because a single traversal is sufficient to get the solution. Now, we want to talk about the complexity of this algorithm. How many traversals can it, how many times will we visit, will we re-enter the while loop? That's the question that we are trying to ask. So, for unidirectional data flow frameworks, when we construct a spanning tree of the graph, and we traverse the graph G in the reverse post order for forward problems and post order for backward problems, then we can identify the number of traversals in the following way. We define a parameter called depth of the graph, depth of G, T, depth of a graph with respect to the spanning tree T, because different spanning trees could give us a different set of back edges, which as I said would not happen if we have a structured graph in which all loops are single entry, but in general it could happen. if we identify maximum number of backages in any acyclic path, so there is a path along which we have to traverse the data flow information, and every time we traverse a backage, which means that some information, maximum number of backages in any acyclic path, so there is a path along which we have to traverse the data flow information, and every time we traverse a backage, which means that some information is fed back to the nodes that we have visited earlier, which means that the maximum number of times we may have to repeat the traversals would depend on the following parameters. The first computation of in and out would take the first iteration, and every time a backage is executed in a path, we traverse. So for convergence, we have to traverse the graph d number of times, and for verifying convergence, we have to traverse the graph one more time. So maximum number of traversals is d plus 2. D plus 1 is for convergence, and the one more iteration is for detection of convergence, for identifying convergence. We are not going to talk about bidirectional bit vector data flow frameworks here. We will talk about other frameworks a little while later, but this is for bit vector frameworks only, and unidirectional bit vector frameworks only. So here is an example depth 2. So we have nested while loops, and the control flow graph looks like this, and the idea is that availability of A plus B in iteration. So we have A plus B, which is available here. It is available here. In iteration one, we discover it is available here. However, because of this assignment to A, this expression ceases to be available. In this path, we find that we have to traverse a certain backage. So this is where the data flow value is being killed, and we want to find out at how many places could this kill traverse, at how many places this bottom value could traverse. So if we imagine the starting of a path here, so we have a path which involves one backage, so which means that in the next iteration this value becomes zero. But in a subsequent iteration, as we traverse, this value reaches here. So we have a path. So we have, therefore, the depth is 2. So 3 plus 1 iterations are required for available expressions analysis. And we're talking about this path. This starts from N5, N4, N7 and goes up to N2. And that involves two backages. And therefore, 3 plus 1 iterations may be required. Note that 3 plus 1 iterations is a bound. It is not something that will always be required. In particular, in this example, if we didn't have this assignment to A here, we would not have required 3 plus iterations for this particular instance of available expressions analysis. So now let's look at a work list based algorithm, because if we were to use round robin algorithm, it means that we have to traverse the graph d plus 2 times, and if d is a higher number, it means that we have to traverse the graph, all the nodes in the graph, so many number of times. An alternative to this is a work list algorithm, where the work list algorithm is quite similar to round robin algorithm in the initialization. So here we say entry node, for entry node we set the value bi, for all other nodes we set the value to top, and we add all nodes to a work list, because initially we will have to process each node at least once, and then later we will identify whether some nodes reprocessing. And now we have a while loop which says while list is not empty, do the following. What do we do? We pick up the node from the head of the list, pick up the first node in the list, remove it from the list, and compute the in value of the node by applying the flow function of the predecessors to the in of predecessors, effectively taking a meet of the out of all the nodes. And if this value is not same as nj, note that we already have an initialization which is top. So we have some initial value here. If this value is not same as nj, which means that the entry value of the node j needs to be revised. So we revise it to make it temp. And because this has changed, It means that it's the values at its successor might also change. So therefore we add successors of j to the list, and once again we go to the while loop entry of the while loop, and because we have added something to the list is not empty. We pick up the next node and we keep repeating this while loop. When the while loop becomes empty, the algorithm converges. So here is a tutorial problem which I will not explain. I will ask you to work it out to ensure that you understand it. I have shown a trace of the algorithm in the following ways. Step number, which node are we processing, meaning this is the node that we have picked up from the head of the work list, and then because we have removed this node, what is the remaining work list and what is the out value that we have changed, what is the out value that we have computed, has it changed, and then have we added any more nodes, and what is the resulting work list. So this is the tutorial problem for available expressions analysis. Note that the round robin method needs to do 3 plus 1 iterations, which is 4 iterations, and the total number of nodes is 7 here. So we process 28 nodes, and we illustrate worklist method for expression A plus B alone. Other expressions are unavailable in the first iteration because of the BI. So this is how we show. So we pick up node N1. So we pick up node N1, and the remaining work list is N2, N3, N4, N5, N6, and we show the out value of node N1. So expression A plus B now becomes available. So the out value is 1. Did it change? So the answer is no, because that is what was its initialization. And because there was no change, we did not add any node to the work list. So we pick up the resulting work list remains same as the remaining work list. Then we pick up the next node from the work list, computes its data flow value. The next node here is this node. There is no kill here, so out of N2 is also 1, but again this is not a change from the initialization, which was the top value. So the remaining work list is this N3, N4, N5, N6, N7. Then we pick up N3, then we pick up N4. The first time we come across a change is when we visit N5. So when we pick up N5, at that time the remaining work list is N6, N7, and now the data flow value of A plus B for N5 at the out becomes 0. Initial value was 1, now it has become 0. So there is indeed a change, and because there is a change, it means that we need to add the successors of this node, and we find that N5 has a single successor, which is N4, and therefore N4 is added to the work list. And here we have added the node to the end of the work list. There can be many ways in organizing the work list. For simplicity, we have added it to N4 at the end. We could have added it to the beginning. We could have maintained the work list in a sorted order. So there are many, many heuristics for maintaining the work list. So we add N4 and then we process N6. We are left with N7, N4. Again at N6, there is no change in the value. At N7, again, there is no change in the value. So we are left with the worklist node N4. Now we process N4. What is N4? So the in of N4 has already become 0. So the out of N4 will become 0 now. This becomes 0 and there is a change, and now we must add the successors of N4. So N4 has successor N5 and N6. So we add N5 and N6 to the work list, and now we pick up N5. There is N6 in the work list, and that is how this algorithm works. Eventually we have N4, we pick up N4 from the work list. There is no change in the value. Its value had already become 0 in an earlier visit, and because there is no change, no node is added, worklist becomes empty, and that's the end of the algorithm. So this is how the worklist based algorithm for iterative data flow analysis works. So how we compare algorithms for round robin analysis and worklist analysis? Note that the line one is same, then there is initialization here. Here we have initialization, and after the initialization here we add everything to the list. Here we set change equal to true, and then we say while change, then there is a for loop over all the loops. So we have a doubly nested loop here, whereas here we have a singly nested loop. We process a node, if there is a change we add its successors to the work list, and then we pick up a node from the work list. So this is a singly nested loop, this is a doubly nested loop here. Here we have a singly nested loop, and therefore you can imagine that this algorithm is more efficient than the round robin algorithm, subject to the overheads of managing the work list, meaning adding nodes to the work list, removing node from the work list, and checking whether the work list is empty. So here is an efficient algorithm for the work list. I will not explain the entire algorithm. I will leave it for you to figure it out. I will explain the basic intuition. So this algorithm combines the traversal order of round robin algorithm with a need based processing of the work list algorithm. So if we were to traverse our round robin algorithm, we traverse using RPO, reverse post order, for forward data flow problems, and post order for backward data flow problems. That gives us the smallest number of iterations that we might need, because we are essentially pushing the values along the natural direction of the data flow, and only where there is a back edge we need to reiterate. So which means that we can have an efficient work list algorithm if the nodes in the algorithm, here nodes are in the first come first served, if instead we maintain the nodes in the algorithm in reverse post order or post order, reverse post order for forward data flow problem and post order for backward data flow problem, if we can do that, then that will be a very efficient algorithm. However, maintaining the nodes in a reverse post order or post order means you have to keep sorting the list, and that has its own overheads. Okay, so we define something called a process node, and we pick up an RPO number. The idea is very simple. We maintain an array which is a work list, and in this array we have one entry per node, and if a node has to be added to the work list, we make the entry 1. If the node is not to be added to the work list, the entry remains 0, and then we use a round robin algorithm that traverses this array, which means that if this entry is 0, the round robin algorithm will simply skip it. So that's the idea. So a round robin algorithm then can, so we might still have while loop and in that a for loop, but the inner for loop will traverse only those nodes for which entries are 1, and this is effectively our work list. So I have given the algorithm here, and I will not go into the details. You can look at this algorithm, and it works in the manner that I explained, and I will once again revise it. I will once again describe it. So we maintain an array of the nodes that need to be processed, and if a node needs to be processed, the corresponding entry is made 1, otherwise corresponding entry remains 0, and a round robin algorithm makes a sweep over this array. If the entry is 1, it computes the data flow values for that node. If the entry is 0, it simply skips it, and when some nodes have to be added, the corresponding entries are in the array are made 1. So we essentially maintain the work list in reverse post order for a forward data flow problem, and we can do the same thing for backward data flow problem by maintaining the work list in a post order. So this gives us a very efficient algorithm of work list, managing work list. So with this we finish this module, but we need to look at why what we have seen here is still not general. We looked at the complexity in terms of number of traversals required. Let's look at a simple case, and that will tell us what is it that we are going to study in the next module. So here is a constant propagation analysis. We have some initial values, a is equal to 5, b is equal to 4, c is equal to 3, d is equal to 2, and then we keep incrementing a is equal to b plus 1, b is equal to c plus 1, and c is equal to d plus 1, and eventually we read d from the input, which means that this value is bottom. This value is unknown. We do not know what value will be read. So since d is bottom, therefore c will become bottom. And because C's data flow value is bottom, therefore the data flow value of B will become bottom. And because the data flow value of B is bottom, therefore the data flow value of A will become bottom. The question is, how many traversals over this graph are required? Had it been a unidirectional bit vector framework, here the depth of the graph is 1, there is exactly 1 backedge. So any acyclic path can have at most 1 backedge. As soon as we traverse the same package again, it becomes a cyclic path, doesn't remain acyclic. So we want to see what happens in constant propagation. So in the first iteration, we discover D to be bottom. Then in the second iteration, because D has become bottom, C becomes bottom. And then in the third iteration, because C has become bottom, B becomes bottom. And in the fourth iteration, because B has become bottom, A has become bottom. And now this value of bottom A needs to be traversed here. So we will need one more iteration. At the entry of 2, we have to know that A is bottom. So in the fifth iteration, we will discover that. Next iteration, we will detect that we have reached a fixed point. Instead of 1 plus 2 here, we 1 plus 2 is 3. Instead of 3 traversals, including detecting a fixed point, we need 6 traversals. In the next module, we will see what is so special about constant propagation that makes it require 6 traversals over the program. This set of slides has some extra material which I don't intend to cover. It's not a part of the course, but if you want to go through it, you can go through it. There will be no exams or quizzes on this material. I will leave these slides with you. And with this lecture, now we have finished the second module, and now we will start with the third module of the course.